そして大空に縦横無尽に駆け巡る海底軍艦の行くところ敵なし、東方が送る世紀の冒険科学巨編、海底軍艦、海底軍艦にご期待ください。
On the surface, Atragon seems like your typical sci-fi invasion fare. Its very concept seems cliché, but the film itself has more to offer than cliché tropes. Atragon is loosely based on the Undersea Warship by Shunru Oshikawa, and the Undersea Kingdom by Shigeru Komatsuzaki. The Undersea Warship featured themes of nationalistic pride that were relevant at the time. Atragon also tackles on those themes, but directed towards the political climate of the 1960s. Jun Tazaki plays Captain Jinguji. Tazaki has played military or authority roles in other films, but this role is different from the rest. It's through Jinguji that we learn the downside of blind nationalism in an age where nationalistic pride is no longer needed. Jinguji refused to accept Japan's surrender and chose to abandon his daughter in favor of building a war sub called the Gotengo for the next two decades in order to restart the war and bring victory to Japan's Imperial Navy. Jinguji comes off as an unlikable character since he refuses to use the Gotengo to save the world from the Mu Empire, claiming that Gotengo was specifically made for defending Japan only. But I found myself feeling sorry for him instead. Jinguji is a man who held on to a war for 20 years while the rest of the world moved on. This may be Jun Tazaki's greatest performance in his career. He delivers a performance of a man who is flawed, yet complex. Ken Uehara's Admiral Kasumi seems to represent the side of Japan that acknowledges Japan's war crimes, feels guilty about it, but has moved on by helping to build a peaceful and prosperous Japan. The Mu Empire seems to represent the fascist side of Japan during World War II. Ishiro Honda does an excellent job of exploring how dangerous and ignorant blind pro-nationalism can be. Honda portrays the Mu Empire as a civilization that is so overconfident in their superiority that it eventually leads to their downfall. Tadao Takashima and Yu Fujiki have great chemistry together like they did in Kong vs. Godzilla. But their characters are misplaced and they contribute very little to the main plot. Akihiko Hirata and Hiroshi Koizumi are criminally underused. Hirata only plays an agent of Mu whose sole purpose is to give exposition, and Koizumi plays a detective whose role is downplayed and literally just goes along for the ride. Koizumi should have been the main character. Yoko Fujiyama as Makoto Jinguji is fairly decent. She is given very little to do except for calling out her father on his bullshit and crying, but when Fujiyama delivers that performance, it's effective. Kenji Sahara delivers one of his best and witty performances of his career. Though his scenes are brief, Sahara chews up every scene he's in. For the longest time, I thought the Empress of Mu was played by Kumi Mizuno, and I didn't find out until last year that it was Tetsuko Kobayashi who played the Empress. Kobayashi plays the part well, but she's not given much to do except glare intently at people, but her suicide scene is quite effective. Akira Fukube delivers a truly magnificent score that switches between somber, militaristic, and mysterious. A few of my personal favorite tracks by Fukube come from this film. The special effects work in this film, for the most part, are top-notch. The details on the Mu Empire sets are impressive. Eiji Tsuburaya outdoes himself with some effect shots, and Gotengo is a sight to behold. But the climax with Manda is outright terrible. The marionette looks unconvincing, and Manda's fight with the Gotengo is short and slow. The third act drags on as well. The third act could have benefited from having a few scenes trimmed to fasten the film's pacing. Overall, Atragon is a great piece of Japanese sci-fi that manages to impress and provide some political food for thought. Though it's flawed in some parts, and could have definitely benefited from another rewrite and trimmed scenes, the film still succeeds in where it matters, such as its music, special effects, performances, and its strong political themes. It's interesting to see Ishiro Honda tackle on a film about nationalistic pride, given that Honda himself was not a nationalist. During his service in World War II, he hated the war with a passion, and heavily disagreed with Japan's leaders on the subject. He only served in the war because he was drafted multiple times. Because of his wartime experience, Honda was able to bring a somber and intriguing perspective on the modern nationalistic themes behind Atragon. Atragon may not be for everyone. Some might even find it boring, but I personally found it fun, entertaining, and politically interesting. Definitely one of Toho's best sci-fi films. I award Atragon 3 stars out of 4.